My mind's telling me no, but my body's telling me.
All right, boys, we're back for another video on the Toyota Supra. And as you can see, parts are slowly coming in for this project. But before we get to the exciting stuff, this is the last episode before the car is actually painted. And it is all about the underside of the car. So I'm going to give you guys a rundown of how I did it, why you want to do it, or why you don't want to do it. And also be comparing it to how I did it on the R34 Skyline, what I've learned along the way. And towards the end of the video, I'm going to be explaining the rear wheel arches, how to fit big wheels under stock wheel arches without rolling them, the pros and cons of cutting them versus not cutting them, and more on that in this episode of Brokensilvia. Brand new 2JZ GT VVTi cylinder head. Let's get it. Before the painting begins, preparation is key. Now, I didn't film the whole process of me cleaning the underside, but pretty much what I did is I degreased it and I power washed it. Then I left it for a few days, let the water evaporate, let it drip out, just to make sure when I start painting, I'm not gonna have any issues. The doors were placed on the stand so they can also receive another light coat of primer before they're ready for paint. And as for the front fenders, they were completely masked off on the outside, so no underbody protection goes on those sections. The first reason why I'm doing the inside of the fenders is to protect them from rock chips. Now, this car is going to be running plastic guard line as the factory ones, so the chance of the inside of the guard actually chipping is very, very slim. But since we're already restoring the whole car and making everything nice and new, figured let's give the inside of the fenders the same treatment as the underside of the car. Now, one thing I would recommend is take your time with the masking. You can see how I have the entire shell masked off and then the engine bay separately. It's easier for you to take your time and mask it properly than it is to remove this undercoating from sections that you didn't want it to stick in the first place. So going back to preparation is key. I pre-mixed my base coat, had it ready to go, so the moment I was done with the undercoating, I could jump straight into the base coat. This one in particular is made by Chromax. It is mixed 2-to-1, meaning two parts base coat, one part thinner or reducer, however you may call it. And everything you see in this video, 90% of my supplies in general, I purchased from the boys over at Global Auto Coat here in WA. So if you need any painting supplies, you know where to go. So now onto the actual undercoating, and there are a couple of ways that you can approach this. And if it was a Nissan, I would go down the route of completely stripping the factory undercoating to bare metal with the seam sealer, just like I did on the R34 Skyline, because Nissan never really did a great job at protecting the underside of the cars, so starting from zero and building up is the best way to do it. This is why we see a lot of Skylines and Silvias being completely torn apart and needing rust repairs, and barely see Supras needing that same treatment. Again, I'm not being biased, I'm personally a Nissan fanboy, but you have to give credit where it's due, and the build of the car is... it's a better built car over in Nissan. Simple as that. It might not be as good looking, but the actual car is a better built car. Now, I was contemplating the idea of completely stripping the underside of the Supra. I did a few sections on the wheel arches. I stripped them back to see if any moisture might have gone through the coating to the metal and started rusting it. And you know what? It was absolutely perfect. So it would have been silly of me to strip it. Instead, I just gave it a bit of a refresh, which in all honesty, probably didn't need either. One coat of Gravitex was sprayed through the whole underside of the car. Approximately 9 liters was used all up, so 9 bottles. And Gravitex is a good product because it's got a little bit of flex to it and it's used on the underside of the car, which is good. However, it is a 1K product. And as you guys know by now, I'm trying to steer away from all 1K products, switch to 2K because it's newer tech, it's more durable. Now, there are a couple of products that are available to us here in Australia, which I'm staying away from just for now, such as the Raptor liner. I've heard that it's more of a bed liner. When you spray it on, it really does become brittle over time and it can crack, which is something that you don't want to be using on the underside of your car. A perfect product that I might have found on the internet used by a car restorer over in the UK that specializes in BMWs is made by 3M called 08800. It comes in 250ml bags, it's a 2K product, and it's approximately 4 times the cost of Gravitech when you add up the difference in when you add it all up. So I'll probably end up reaching out to one of the boys from the UK and seeing if they can send me out a huge batch of that product that we can use on Dale's R32 GDR, because that car really does deserve all the protection it can get so we never see rust coming through it ever again. We'll be right back.
way you do it. You play the guitar on MTV. That ain't working, that's the way you do it. Money for nothing and your chicks for free. Now that ain't working, that's the way you do it. Let me tell you, damn guys ain't dumb. Maybe get a blister on your little finger. Maybe get a blister on your thumb. We got to install microwave ovens, custom kitchen deliveries. We got to move these refrigerators. We got to move these color TVs. The little faggot with the earring and the makeup. Yeah, buddy, that's his own hair.
By now, I'm pretty sure you can see my excitement. I was absolutely stoked on this color, and it was being painted over a rough textured surface. So you can imagine when the whole car is painted, I'm probably gonna cry. But yeah, very exciting times ahead. So once again, now we're onto the stage of applying the base coat to the underside of the car. And I'm gonna talk about a couple of options available and why I did it this way. On my R34 Skyline, I used a 1K enamel paint to seal in the Gravitex. Now, it does work, it is holding up okay, but there are products out there that are a little bit more chemical resistant and probably are better suited for the underside of the car. Moving on Brandon's R33 Skyline, I used a 2K polyurethane paint. And on the Supra, I decided that I want to completely one-to-one color match the exterior of the car to the underside, which is deep jewel green, as you can see by now. And that way, I decided to use a base coat and a clear coat over the top of the Gravitex, just like you would on the exterior of the vehicle. So in terms of durability, the 1K in theory would be the weakest, the 2K polyurethane would be the hardest, and the 2K base coat with the clear coat over the top would be situated somewhere in the middle. Now the 2K polyurethane is a industrial paint. This is what is used on machinery. It is a 2K product. It is very chemical resistant as well. And usually you only get them mixed up in solid colors, meaning there is no fleck or metallic in them. So the reason why I decided to go down the pathway of base coat and clear coat is I could one-to-one color match my color, meaning that the exterior of the car and the underside, as I said, is the exact same color. In the future, what I might actually try is I might try to get the metallic color mixed up in the direct gloss, also known as the polyurethane paint, and see how that turns out. At the end of the day, the underside is never even seen. So if the color match is 90%, that should be good enough. And having the availability of having this color mixed up in a polyurethane paint would probably better suit the underside of the car. So that's definitely something to try out for next time, but just a bit of an idea of what I did do. Now, approximately 1.25 liters of base coat was used on the underside of the car, and the next day I pushed the car into a way more ventilated area and applied one thick of automotive clear coat, which is also 2K, on the underside of the finish to further seal it in, make it nice and glossy. It'll be nice and easy to clean. You could theoretically ceramic coat it just like you would the exterior of a car, and it'll be super nice and easy to clean. But again, we'll see how it holds up and if this is the method we should choose for future projects. So I'll take a moment now to talk about the rear wheel arches. I decided to cut mine off for two reasons. As my friend Paul Roseboom explained, once you cut the rear wheel arches off, you get maximum clearance and there's no potential of dirt and debris getting stuck in there and rusting out the metal. The only thing you're gonna have to do is you're gonna have to give it a little bit of an epoxy or edge primer and use some seam sealer between those two skins. Now, when I say skins, we're talking about the inner skin or the inner metal being the structure of the car or the wheel tub, the outer skin being the rear quarter panel. When those two pieces of metal meet together, they form the lip. And when you lower your car, you put big wheels on it, what ends up happening is your tire hits that lip and it rubs. So what people usually do is they get them rolled, but unfortunately it does slightly distort the metal on the exterior of the panel. And I've seen it happen time and time, even on my R34 Skyline. If you do look close enough, it has a small distortion. As Paul did mention, the best thing is just to completely remove that lip. Those two skins or the two metals are still butted up to one another, meaning that this section here still remains strong and it's not flexible, like it's not just going to bend. No dirt, no debris, no rust, maximum clearance. It's a pretty simple task, so do it. Alright boys, so we are slowly approaching another video. Done this take a couple of times and I look like I haven't had sleep in 7 days, but yeah, as you guys saw at the start of the video, parts are slowly starting to come in, and for me it's pretty exciting to an extent because a lot of the stuff that's coming in is brand new, and most of the time in the past what I've dealt with is other people's secondhand stuff that I've had to refurbish or parts that I really didn't want to put on the car, like my intake manifold on the Skyline and some other bits and pieces. The Supra is going to be a well thought out car, keeping it a very basic street car but still a fun street car. And as I said, sometimes it's actually better to buy a brand new part than buying someone else's secondhand junk, because you're going to end up paying twice. So I think that's the main thing I've learnt. But another thing I've learnt about myself is I'm not emotionally attached to this Toyota Supra. That's made the project really enjoyable because I haven't had to stress or overthink things. If it works, boom, done, let's buy it. While with the Skyline, because I'm so emotionally attached to the story of the car, me wanting to travel Europe in it, like so many options, like rear-wheel drive, four-wheel drive, manual, DCT, everything costs a shit ton of money for the Skyline compared to the Supra, like as they say, GTR tax. I really do think I could build 3 Supras for the price of 1 Skyline. Everything's just so affordable. Like you go to Toyota, man, you buy a brand new cylinder head. Like you could probably get 3 of these cylinder heads for the price of an RB26 one. I'm not even kidding. It's been pretty cruisy. It's been enjoyable. I'll run you guys through all the parts I've purchased, but I'll just give you a bit of an insight of what's to come. Next week's episode is a bit of a filler episode with my friend James. We're talking about how he accidentally built an R34 GTR, meaning he bought a GTT, did the whole GTR exterior conversion, and also converted it from rear-wheel drive to four-wheel drive. We'll give you guys a glimpse of what he's done so far. It's a running car. It's not driving because it's got no drive shaft. Then the week after that, I keep saying it, but the Supra really should be painted by then. And once the car is painted, that's a whole episode on its own. I might introduce you guys to Dale's R32 GTR and what I've done so far, or we'll give you guys a rundown of all the parts that have come in for the Toyota Supra, and we might use the black Targa top as the one for the fabrication. That was always the initial plan, is to scratch up the Targa top because it's going to get restored anyways, so then we can finalize the fabrication work on the Targa top, and just when the Supra, the two-door, the green one, is ready, we can just bounce the drivetrain in it, do the wiring, and it's good to go. As I said, easier said than done, but that's the plan of attack. And the video is here to hold me accountable. Catch you later. Che vuole questa musica stasera? Che mi riporta un poco del passato. La luna ci teneva.